What's up, guys? Got a video for you here. I kind of meant to put up this past week. I'm actually filming it on Saturday, which is the day after I put up the last video that I had up, which is the underrated metal records video series that I've kind of been perpetuating over, I don't know, about a year and a half or so on my channel. So this time here, I got a video that I was kind of hoping would turn into more of a thread. I would love to see some responses from some other people who also have opinions about classic records. Obviously, if you've read the title, this is Overrated Metal Classics. So these are not obscure bands. These are classic albums that I myself consider overrated. Now, full disclosure, overrated does not mean I dislike them. Overrated does not mean they are not incredibly influential, especially if they are, because there are a couple in here that are very influential. And overrated does not mean that they are objectively bad by any means, because obviously this is all my opinion. So before I get into it, now that I've stated the absolute most obvious thing in the world, but for whatever reason people still feel the need to comment some stupid crap, underrated metal classic, Sirith Ungol, Frost and Fire. Gotta have an awesome, awesome record going on in the background. I absolutely love this band. I've been more on a Norwegian black metal kick, but I wanted something objectively classic, and I didn't want to hear the keyboard warriors, "Oh, you're talking crap about Slayer, but you're listening to that static Norwegian garbage in the background." So I just decided to put Sirith Ungol on. Yeah, I'm always so positive on this channel. I wanted to switch it up for once. This is Deathwish Cold Brew is what I'm drinking. It's the morning, so I'm not drinking beer. It is my day off, but I'm good. I got stuff to do. So, Nastrovia. I got this on clearance, and it's slightly sweet. Not a huge fan of the slightly sweet. I wish it was just black, but it was on clearance at Jewel. All right, so I'm going to start off with a hot take. Obviously, these are all going to be kind of hot takes. But South of Heaven by Slayer, I don't really like this record. I like songs off of it, but as a whole, this album is kind of a snoozer. I really like the tune Silent Scream, Mandatory Suicide, Ghosts of War, and the rest of them, they're okay. I don't love it. The Judas Priest cover is kind of cool. You guys have all seen this CD, but there's just something about this that they really, it feels like somebody pulled the rug out from under them. You know what I mean? Obviously, I knew they were like, "We're never going to top Rain and Blood, so let's make something completely different," which I do respect that. But this is such a change immediately, it doesn't work all that well. They went really soft, really quick, and I think Seasons in the Abyss would be a much better transitionary record. I like Seasons in the Abyss quite a bit. I like that way more than this record. If that came out first and then this one would make more sense. But the abrupt nature and complete change of sound held on here is weird. It's way more melodic. You guys have all heard it. You guys know what's going on here. So that one is going to be number one. I have 10 here. Do as many as you want. If you're going to do a response, I would love to see them. Next, Immolations, Failures for Gods. This one is a good record. I do like this record. I am actually a decently big Immolation fan. But for me, mid-era Immolation is where it's at. They kind of started off a little bit boring. And the production on this record is does it no favors whatsoever, I must say that for sure. The aesthetics are interesting. It looks like some kind of demon looking over hordes of tortured souls, I presume. But this record is really blasty. The production's really flat. It's got, you know, classics on here, you know, just textbook Immolation, you know, live set staple kind of tunes on it. But I really do think that they didn't really hit the sweet spot up until later on in the 2000s. So I would consider this one a bit on the overrated side because I've heard lots of people praising this over and over. Next, you guys have heard me talk about this. Most of my issues here are boring. And this is no change. This is Point of Entry by Judas Priest. You guys have heard me talk about this one before, and I'm not a huge fan of this record. I really do love Judas Priest, especially, the classic records for the most part. I even like Ram It Down from what I've heard. I don't own it, so I've heard a little bit of it. But Point of Entry is kind of nap time. I put this on and I'm like, basically almost immediately, man. Hot Rockin's great. Troubleshooter's a cool song. But like the rest of this, give me the pillow, give me the blanket, and I don't even need a couch, man. Put this thing on, I'll fall asleep on a concrete floor. Next, Let the Hate Flow Through You. Dismember is like an ever-flowing stream. I really, really, really do like this album. It took me a long time to get into this. I talked about this in my entry to Pat's Evolving Opinions contest. I talked about this record, and it's a great record. It's a good record. But people praise this as the greatest record to come out of Sweden, objectively, like inarguably the greatest record to come out of Sweden, which obviously I'm well aware that's an opinion, so it's not actually objective, no matter what kind of exaggerations are expunged from one's mouth. But I don't know, man. It's just, why is this so much better than all the other stuff to come out of Sweden? I think Entombed's more entertaining. Grave is more fun to listen to. My favorite band in Sweden is Opeth, but that's because I'm kind of a big fan of the prog going on there. Catatonia's from Sweden. I mean, At the Gates, come on. Dissection, even though it's more of a black metal band, are you kidding me? This is not even close. So this is a great, great death metal album. It's very good. It's very entertaining. I enjoy it quite a bit, but I do think it is overhyped. Next, a band that I've had such a weird relationship with this band over the years. I've really loved them at certain points, and then other points I hear it and I'm like, this is annoying. And then sometimes I'm kind of like, whatever, they're a cool band. And now these days, I'm kind of like, I like some of their records. They have more bad records than they do good albums, and even the good records I don't think are as great as some of the other thrash bands. But this is So Far So Good, So What? For a long time, this was my favorite Megadeth album. And I exclusively attribute that to In My Darkest Hour, which is one of, if not my favorite Megadeth songs ever. But honestly, this kind of suffers from South of Heaven syndrome, where there's a couple really good songs like In My Darkest Hour and Hook in Mouth, Into the Lungs of Hell. And then like two-thirds of it is like more, you know, nap time. It's cool. It sounds kind of sloppy. I know they are pretty strung out at this point, pretty drunk all the time, pretty, you know, high off probably heroin, from what I understand from Megadeth's history. So they do get a pass for that in an extent, being a mess, because I'm sure that does ruin lives, and I guarantee you, I've seen it happen, or I know of it happening. But it just doesn't really hold up compared to their peers. What year did this come out? It's either 88 or 87. I think it was 87. So 87, Testament's debut, Pleasures of the Flesh, what else? Dark Angel's debut, Sodom put out, what did they put out in 87? I don't think Sodom put out anything in 87. But you guys, you get my point. This definitely should have fallen more into obscurity, comparatively speaking. I think most of the Megadeth traction stems from Dave Mustaine's small stint in Metallica, even though he is a huge hand in the creation of the first couple of albums. They did use his riffs and all that, which is awesome. He's well deserved, great guitar player, all that. But this record is kind of meh. A couple more here. I think I'm out into the final five here. This is in no real order. I just kind of tried to diversify it so I didn't talk about death metal, thrash. I just kind of threw it all together. This is another album I've had evolving opinions about, Pat. I could have thrown this into that video. But Domination by Morbid Angel. For a long time, this was by far my favorite Morbid Angel record. But upon further diving into their catalog, I think that it is definitely a less than savory record, comparatively speaking, to the rest of them. I do like quite a few of these songs on here, but there's some things that kind of harp on me. But my main idea, my main issue with this one is the hype. I've heard it said from specifically Michael Akerfeldt's mouth specifically, this is the greatest death metal record of all time, and it's impossible to top. And I beg to differ, my friend, because first off, Michael's one of my favorite musicians of all time. He's the leader of my favorite death metal band, and he cites this as the best death metal record of all time. And I have no clue what kind of delusion he's going through, because there is stuff that smokes this, dude, that came out before it and after it. Tons of stuff. The riffs are fun. David Vincent's vocals are weird. Obviously, they have I think it's called a phaser that's going on in the background. And it's, you know, it's good stuff. I do like to listen to this album a lot. Stuff like Eyes to See really, really works. The first couple songs are cool, but his vocals are really weak. They were never, like, the heaviest and nastiest thing in the world, though. Altars of Madness, those vocals, dude, so good. And I like the clean vocals in Covenant that get used in, like, multiple tracks, actually. But on this record, it sounds tired. It sounds like they're bored. The production's a little flat, too, but the biggest issue I have is the vocals. And I do really like Eric Rutan's kind of keyboardy interludes. I think it's really cool. I really do like the song Caesar's Palace. Great, great track off of here. But yeah, it's a great record. But for me, Domination's a great record. But compared to the rest of the Morbid Angel catalog, I think it's overrated. Next, a band that I do like a lot. But this record I recently picked up and I was not impressed. This is Elegy by Amorphis. Definitely a classic metal record. 96, this one dropped. These guys are really trend hopping on this one, it sounds like. They were getting really progressive and kind of Middle Eastern, which wasn't necessarily the trend of the time. But the big issue for me was the embracing of the grunge era. And man, if there are two genres I hate, it is industrial and grunge. And at this point, that was all over. That was a cancer spreading amongst the limbs of the metal scene, all over the place. And this fell victim to some grungy influence. I didn't really pick up too much industrial ideas in here, but it is really, really lackluster, especially tailing the last two records. I mean, come on. This is just kind of, it's not a faceplant, but it's definitely a stumble. They did retain some really good stuff later on. I'm looking at them from here, I can't think of it. I think it's the 2014 record, the Beyond the Red Cloud, I think is what it's called. Really good record. But this record, it doesn't sit with me all that well. And I know, I've never really heard anybody gushing about this one, to be honest with you. But I do know there's a lot of fans of this record. And it's considered a classic, and I think it doesn't deserve the love that it gets. Alright, let's bring about the hate train, because these two of these last three, I think, are going to invoke the flames of vengeance upon the local metal nerds on my channel. This is Carcass with Heartwork, another band I have had such a weird relationship with, man. I've never really been a diehard Carcass guy. I do like Carcass. I have most of their albums. Not all of them. But This record in particular, it's good, I guess. It's kind of boring. Maybe I was just like, I'm not a huge, huge melodic death metal guy, right? 93, that's really early. This is one of the first, if not the first, melodic death metal albums of all time. But it just does not really work for me. In the way that Necroticism does. And Symphonies of Sickness does. But, I don't know how to properly verbalize my opinion on this record. Because I really do like it. But it's just so... it's so praised. Some people call this... actually, a lot of people call this their favorite metal record of all time. And, you know, more power to you, man. I wish I would love this more than I do. Because I would love to gush over more Carcass than the first three. And then be like, eh, for the rest of their catalog. Like, I kind of am at this point. But, obviously, I'm going to keep these around. And I'm going to try to listen to these. Next time I'm in a melodic death metal mood, I will definitely be revisiting this. With hopes of really having it click in my ears. But yeah. Another band I'm a recent fan of, because it took me so long to get into grindcore. This is Utopia Banished by Napalm Death. Another band everybody's always talking about, man. People love this band. I really like the one from before this, from Enslavement to Obliteration. Scum is a pretty good record too, but honestly, I hate Barney Greenway's vocals. He's like, I don't love the first Benediction stuff because he's on there. I don't like how his voice sounds. I kind of find it annoying. It sounds weak. It sounds forced, and it sounds uncomfortable. And it does not fit super well. Like, these riffs, if they had a really good vocalist on here, this record would smoke. But because he's always, you know, basically shouting with a mouthful of food, particularly probably something large, you know, like mashed potatoes, you know. All right. He's screaming with a mouthful of mashed potatoes at all times. And he's over pretty much all of the riffs all the time. He does not seem to let everything breathe. He kind of suffocates what he's on. He covers everything in the gravy from his mashed potato mouth and kind of suffocates every song and makes the record as bland as unsalted mashed potatoes. All right, last one. The Ultimate Sin by Ozzy Osbourne. I love Ozzy, man. Who doesn't love Ozzy? He's great. Most of his catalog from back in the day is great. I like all of the stuff all the way up through No More Tears. And beyond that, he starts getting a little rough. But that is okay because there's a plethora of great records. Like five or six really good records from... what's the first one? Diary of a Madman? All the way to No More Tears. I think it's six records. But this is kind of a forgettable one in that catalog. But I really do think this is one of the better album covers in Ozzy's history. This one, and I really love the Bark at the Moon cover. I honestly, I'm looking at this track title, and I couldn't think of one that I've been like, oh wow, this is like a really standout track. Maybe Shot in the Dark, maybe, but that in itself is a shot in the dark because I barely remember it. I've heard this record, I've had the CD for like 10 years, not even 10 years. When did I start collecting this? Like 8 or 9 years. And I honestly, I don't remember it. I should listen to it some more. Maybe try to let it fester a little bit in my eardrums for a little while. But it's kind of hard to when you see all this stuff that I got here. As you can see right here, this is my non-metal section. The Marty Robbins is, they're glaring you in the face. But all that is the metal back there. And then there's overflow there. There's well over 1,000 metal CDs down here. It's hard to go be like, oh, I have all this stuff that I'm well aware of, I'm a big fan of, and I haven't heard in, I don't know, 6 months. And then I'm going to go listen to something that I think is eh, and try to get into it again. That's something that's hard for me to do, because I have so much stuff that I know I love and I want to listen to again to get to know even better than I already do. For example, Cirith Ungol, or my Morgana Le Fay records, or some of the, you know, I don't know, some of the other stuff that I have in the Atmospheric Black Metal catalog, which is all over there. It's my favorite genre of metal. So, I don't know. I'll let it fester one of these days, but for now, I'm going to cut it off right here. So, overrated metal classic records. No genuine hate for any of these records. They all have their place in history, obviously. This is all common sense. If you don't understand this, you should probably step away from your computer. You might hurt yourself or others around you. So I would love to see some other people hop on this thread that I'm trying to start here. Please feel free to do responses, tag me, hashtag whatever, Life Eternal or overrated metal classics or something like that. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Keep it greasy.